The Olympics is an institution that celebrates physical perfection and sporting achievement, but it's also become a way of demonstrating national pride and bigging up the host city so that millions of people around the world and visiting tourists can see just how brilliant we are. And nothing symbolises this more than the architecture. Not the old fusty stuff, the historic things, but the dazzling new array called Olympic architecture. But hosting the Olympic Games is a gamble with an awful lot of money. So what's the best way to spend it? The usual way to do it is old school, like Beijing 2008 or Athens 2004, blowing your billions on cavorting buildings that simultaneously display whatever propaganda message you want. In Athens, that meant reminding us that when the Olympics began, Greece ruled the world. And Beijing made it clear who's in charge now. However, once the show's moved on, you're usually left with rather expensive white elephants. Remember this one? Nope, nobody else did either. In Montreal 1976's case, it took the city 30 years to pay for an iconic stadium that no one's ever heard of. So what does London 2012's Olympic architecture represent? In the final phases of construction, getting up close and personal is still tricky. But in the stakes of iconography, it's easy to see there are some showstoppers. And in terms of Olympic white elephantitis, they seem fairly immune. Cycling is a sport we're good at, and it looks like we're good at designing the arenas too. The Olympic velodrome is camera friendly, but for my money, so much more. My second postcard-friendly lovely is the Aquatic Centre by Dame Zaha Hadid. More of a conceptual and financial risk. Poetic beauty like this doesn't come cheap. But at least it's a gamble that seems to have paid off, practically and aesthetically. And then there's the main track and field stadium, a stickier prospect. Described by one critic as painfully pragmatic, it's the one venue that seems to have underwhelmed and disappointed us all in the run-up to the Games. Iconic it isn't, but it's actually the most radical building of all. The stadium's future use is still being decided, but its architects, Populous, made plans for it not to be here at all. Everything you see above ground was designed to be taken down, like IKEA shelving, and used somewhere else, maybe at the next Olympics. Now that is radical. Temporary and mobile architecture of this scale is an idea that dates from the 1960s and a visionary group of architects known as Archigram. One of its founders, Peter Cook, was a consultant for the design of the stadium. Often more like science fiction and fantasy, their futuristic designs were all about adaptability, even mobility, and these ideas have filtered through to many of the structures built to accommodate the 2012 Games. This concept of the Olympics as a travelling roadshow has been watered down considerably, but it has left its mark. With the same flexibility as a wedding marquee, the basketball arena may end up at the next Olympics in Rio, and the shooting gallery in Woolwich may be seen again in Glasgow at the Commonwealth Games. In Athens, out of 32 sporting venues, 22 were permanent and purpose-built. In London, it's only 6, and that shows you something's changed. These buildings aren't set to be added to the list of architectural Olympic follies. In a very British way, what is beautiful and radical about them is their very practicality. And I believe it's this approach that'll become the future model for hosting the Games.